Hello students, so today we will start with the new chapter that is the second chapter of biology, tissues. Okay, so before we go further to understand, let me tell you one thing, and that is, you know that our body, it is made up of a very small unit, and that unit is known as cell. Even all the living organism, their body is composed of a fundamental unit, and that is known as cell. Okay, and on the basis of the number of the cells in a particular living organisms, they are basically divided into unicellular and multicellular organism. So when we talk about the unicellular organisms, so you know, student, that it is composed of only one cell. So the single cell, it used to perform all the basic life activities. Okay, like in case of amoeba, you see, amoeba has to perform all the life activities by engulfing of that of the food, we can say by intaking of the food, or digestion, or osmoregulation, or respiration, as well as that of excretion. So all these functions have to be performed by that of the single cell of amoeba. But when you talk about the multicellular organism, we know that the multicellular organism, it is basically composed of more than one type of a cell. So you see that a particular cells or a few cells, they combine together, or they in a group perform a special function. And by this, all the cells, they are divided with their work. Or we can say that the group of cells, they perform a certain special function which help in carrying our life activities. For example, if you see the muscle cells, so the muscle cells, they together help in the contraction as well as that of the relaxation of our body. It help in the movement of our body. When you talk about the nerve cells, these nerve cells or neurons help in carrying the messages from one part of the body to the brain, or from the brain to the different parts of the body. Or you can see, in if we see that of the plant, so the plants are also having cells like that of a xylem or a phloem, or we can say that it is having cells which help in carrying the water and minerals from one part of the plant to the another, or it help in carrying the food from one part of the plant to the other. So you see that here in multicellular organisms, the cells are divided with their functions. Okay, so you see that these cells in a group, they perform a function, and that's why they are very important for us. So what is we called such group of cells, because we have studied about the cell itself. So these group of cells, when they arrange themselves, when they combine with each other, or when they group themselves, that is known as a tissue. So before we go further and study about tissue, we should know the meaning of the tissue. Okay, so tissue is what in the previous one we have studied about the cell, student, and we came to know that a cell is the fundamental unit of our life. So when these cell, they combine together with that of the other cell, they make a group of a cell. And these group of a cell, they are similar in structure as well as they are having the similar function also. Okay, so they are similar in structure that work together to perform the particular function. So we can define tissue that it is a group of a cell which is having the similar structure as well as they are having the similar function. Now all the cells of a tissue, they are having a common origin. okay, they belongs to a same origin. For example, if suppose you are taking if you take the example of a human nervous system, nervous tissue, okay, so you know that the this nervous tissue, it is present in our brain, in our spinal cord, as well as these nervous tissues are present in the nerves itself. Okay, so human nervous tissue, they are having a nerve cells or the neurons, and these nerve cells or that of the neurons, they all are having the same structure as well as they perform the same function. So they are basically same structurally as well as functionally. Okay, so we can say that the tissues, all the cell of the tissues, they belongs to a same origin, they belongs to a common origin. Now you can take an example of a nervous cell. If suppose you see the nervous cell, so all the nerve cells, it is basically consisting of a cell body, or we called it a soma. This cell body, it is having a nucleus in it, which is present at the center part of the neuron, and which has two type of branches in it, that is dendrite to receive the message, as well as a axon is also a kind of a branch which start from that of the, which is attached to that of the cell body. Dendrite is there to receive the message, while axon is there to convey the message away from that of the cell body to the other nerve cell. Now, all the neurons, you see, of that of the nervous tissue, it is originated from the same germinal layer. Okay, and that is known as the ectoderm. When we say about the same germinal layer, we are talking about the layer. So these all are obtained from the ectoderm. They all are derived from the ectoderm. Okay, or we can say it is derived from the neural ectoderm. Okay, so they, every neuron cell, whether it is present in that of the brain or it is present in the spinal cord or in the nerves, they all are having the same origin. They all are having the common origin. You see the that of the muscular tissue. So the cells of the muscular tissue function is the same, only they all perform the contraction and relaxation, which help us in moving our body. As well as you can see in case of a plant cell tissue also, in plant cell, the vascular tissues, the function of the vascular tissue is the same, and that is it help in conducting the water and food from one part of a plant to the other. Okay, so these are the tissue and how they are having the same structure and that of the function. Now, this term tissue, the term tissue, it is coined by a French pathologist, and that is known as Marie-Francio Xavier Bichat. Okay, Bichat was also known as the father of the histology. Now, what is histology, students? This term histo means tissue, okay, and logos or logy, that is mean is study. So we can say histology is that branch of the science in which we study about tissue. Okay, so study of the tissue is called as histology. Okay, so Bichat was known as the father of histology. Bichat was working with the tissues without any of the microscope, students. Okay, but even then also he was able to distinguish 21 type of elementary tissues from which the organ of the human bodies are composed. Okay, now one more researcher, one more pathologist was there, that is Marcello Malfigi. Marcello, he was considered as the founder of histology. Okay, and the term histology was coined first of all in 1819 by Mayer. Okay, so these are some of the important terms. Maybe ask in a one word in exam that who is known as the father of histology. Then you will write Bishop was that person that is known as that of the father of histology also. So he was that pathologist who termed the tissue. Okay. And the term histology was coined by Mayer in 1819. And Marcello Malfigi is considered as a father of histology. Okay. Now we will talk that what is the importance of the tissue in our body? Why tissues are important in our body? Okay, so the first importance is that it help in the formation of a tissue has brought about a division of labor in a multicellular organism. So right now we discuss about the division of labor, student, and in division of labor the work are distributed among the different types of a group of a cells. So the tissue help, or the formation of a tissue help the division of the labor in that of a multicellular organism. Okay, now the second function is that these tissues, when they organized, when they combine, then they form or they become an organ, and that organ together with the other organ form a system, and that is known as a organ system. So tissue, it becomes organized to form organs, and the organ into the organs, it organizes itself into a system, and that is known as an organ system. So this is the second importance of a tissue, that how tissue help in forming a organ system in a human body. The workload of an individual cell, or the function which was performed only by a cell, this workload has decreased due to the origin of the tissue. Because you know that one cell cannot perform all the function, but a group of a cell somehow reduce the workload of the individual cell. So we can say that due to the formation of the tissue, the workload of the individual cell has decreased. Okay. Now, because of the decrease in the workload of the tissues, there it help in improving the organization, as well as it increases the efficiency, and it also help in the survival of the multicellular organisms. Okay, so we can say that as the workload decreases, or due because of the division of the labor, the organization of a human body or of a system, it increases, efficiency increases, as well as the survival of an organism also get increased. Okay. So you see, formation of a tissue has brought about a division of labor. So division of labor occur. Tissue, it becomes organized to form organ and organ system. Tissue help in formation of the organ, and the organ, it forms a system that is known as an organ system. And due to the coming of the tissue, tissue help in decreasing the workload of an individual cell. And because of that, because of all these things, it results into an improved organization, which are having a higher efficiency of that of the multicellular organism, and help it in a long time survival. So these are the importance of a tissue in a multicellular organism. Okay. Now we are saying, student, that these tissues are present in the animals as well as these tissues are present in the plants also, and they are, because these are basically present in that of the multicellular organisms, and we know plant and animals both are the multicellular organisms. So the question arises that whether the tissue which is present in that of the plant or in the animals is they are same or they are made up of a different type of a tissue. Okay, student. So you see, when you see the plants, so plants and animals, they are of a different type of organisms. How? Plants are autotrophic. So as they are autotrophic organisms, so they prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis. Now, plants, they are stationary. They cannot move from one place to the another place in the search of the food. Okay, so they remain placed at a one place itself. They are fixed. They cannot move. Okay, and since they do not consume or need much energy, so most of the plant tissues, they are supportive. And they provide them with a structural strength. Okay, so plants, they do not move. Most of the cells, they provide the mechanical support and strength to their branches, to their trunk. So most of the tissues, it consisting of a dead cell, because they provide the mechanical support and strength to the plant. Okay, so most of the tissues which is present in the plant, their basic function is give structural strength or give support to that of the plant. Now in that of the plant tissues, the growth of the tissue, there are some tissues in the plant which divide throughout their life. Okay, so they divide for the growth and that of the reproduction of the plant. Okay, so we can say that the growth of the plant take place only in some region of the plant. Okay, so the division take place at a certain place, and the division occurs only in the some of the tissues in the plant. So such ever dividing tissues which are localized in the certain region of the plant body, they are having the a good dividing capacity, and these are classified, or these are said to be as a meristematic tissues. Okay, while there are some tissues which divide, but later on it do not divide. Okay, or we can say that which divide up to a certain period of a time, afterward it do not divide, that is known as a permanent tissue. So meristematic tissue, it divides and its division help in the growth of the plant, while the permanent tissue, it do not divide at all. Okay, so the plant tissues, they are having a kind of a tissue which provide mechanical support and strength. They are having the kind of a tissue which gives provide a structural strength to the plants, as well as they are autotrophic. So most of the tissue like xylem, phloem, sclerenchyma, they are dead tissues, and thus they do not contain a living protoplasm. While if you see in case of animal tissues, animals, they are heterotrophic organism. So if they are heterotrophic, it means they have to take their food from the others. So they have to move in a search of a food, a mate, and as well as to find the shelter. Okay, so if they are not able to make their food, they have to search for the food. And because of that, they move from place to place. Okay, and to move from one place to the another, the animals, they need more energy than that of the plants. Okay, so most cell and the tissue in the animal cell, they are the living cell, that is, they are having a living protoplasm. plasm. So this is the difference between that of the plant tissue and the animal tissue. In the plant tissue, they cannot move since they are able to make their own food. They are able to prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis. And because of that, most of the tissues, because they are standing at a place, they are stationary, they are fixed at a place. So they need a such kind of a tissue which gives support, which gives a strength to the plant so that they can stand forever. Okay, that's why they are having most of the tissues which are dead, like that of the sclerenchyma, cork, and these do not having the protoplasm. But in case of an animal, they are heterotrophic, they need food, they need shelter, and for that they used to move from one place to the another, and for movement they need energy. So more energy they need as compared to the plant, and that's why most of the tissue in the animals, they are living. Now, the growth of the animals is more uniform, so animals do not have a separate dividing and a non-dividing cells. Okay, they are having organs which are having a specialized function. Okay, so their growth of the tissues, their growth is uniform. So there is no such a division in which our tissue is having the power of a division and the tissue does not divide at all. Here, the organs are divided and these organs, they perform a special function. So these are the things by which we can say the plants, they are having a different kind of a tissue as compared to that of the animals. Now we can summarize that difference between the plant and animals with the help of a table. So you see, student, since animals are mobile, if the first difference between the animals and the plants, the animals, they are mobile, so they require more energy and hence more living tissues are required. Right now I said about that they, if they locomote, they used to change the position in search of the food, in search of the mate, in search of a shelter, and that's why it need more living tissue as compared to the plant. Plants, they are stationary, so they do not require this much energy. They are fixed at a place, they are not moving, that's why they need less energy, and hence more dead tissues are there, or the living tissues are less as compared to that of animal tissues. The animal, it moves from place to place in search of a food shelter, hence they need more energy and there are more tissues are living. The same thing that I had explained in the first one also. Here, most of the tissues are dead. It provides mechanical strength as easily as the living ones and need less maintenance. As compared to that of the animal tissue, it need less maintenance. Cell growth is uniformly distributed. Here, right now I explained that the cell growth is uniformly. So there is no division of the cell into a dividing cell and that of the non-dividing cell. But if you see in a plant tissues, the growth is limited. Means the dividing cells is present at a certain region. So wherever the dividing cells are present, growth will occur at that region, and that's why we say the growth is limited to a certain region. Where the permanent tissue is present, they do not divide at all, thus that portion of the plant will not going to divide. Now, the structural organization of an organ and organ system is more specialized and complex. In case of an animal tissue, you know that the division is uniform, but they are having a special kind of organs, and these organs, they combine together to form an organ system. And this organ system make it more specialized and complex. But here in the plant tissue, this structural organization is not that much complex like that in case of a plant tissue. There are a lot of other differences are like plant tissues, they require less maintenance energy. They require less maintenance energy as compared to that of the animal tissues. There, the plant tissues, they are basically divided into meristematic and the permanent. But animal tissue, such differentiation is not there. Okay. Here, in case of a plant tissue, since it is divided into a dividing cell and a non-dividing cell, the division is forever. Or we can say, due to presence of such tissue in a plant, it continue to grow throughout the life. But animals, they do not show such kind of a growth. After reaching a maturity, the growth occurs, but after that, it ceases. Okay, so such division which occur throughout the life is not possible in case of animal tissue. Okay, tissue organization is meant for a stationary habit of a plant, because the plant is fixed. So habit is tissue organization is such that plant can stand properly, can be erect. But tissue organization in case of animal tissue is targeted towards the high mobility of an animal. So here the organization of the tissue is such that animals can move or can locomote from one place to the another place very easily. So these are the tissues by which makes it differ from that of the animal tissue or to that of the other tissue. This is the difference between the plant and the animal tissues. Now we will see the plant tissues. So plant tissues are basically classified into two types of tissue. The cell, the tissue which is a group of a cell which is having a power of a division, which can divide, and a group of a cell which are known as the mature cell and which are incapable of division, or we can say which are not able to divide further. So we will see here the division of the plant tissue, students. So you can see here the plant tissue, first of all, it is basically divided into two. That is the meristematic tissue and the permanent tissue. Meristematic cells or meristematic tissue is that type of a tissue which is having a cells which are capable of a division. Okay, so we were talking about a type of a cell which are capable of division throughout the life. That kind of a tissue is known as a meristematic tissue. If you see the group of a cell which are not able to divide, it is incapable of a cell division. That type of a tissue is known as a permanent tissue. Okay, so permanent tissues, they are the mature tissues. So as they are mature, it means they are they will not going to divide further. Now this permanent tissues, okay. Now, these permanent tissues, they are also classified into two. That is simple tissue or the complex tissue. Simple tissue is that kind of a tissues which are composed of only one kind of a cells. Okay, if only one kind of a cell is present, that is known as a simple tissue. And the complex tissue is what? Which consisting of more than one type of cells in it. Okay, that is a complex tissue. Now again, these simple tissues are divided into three, and that is parenchyma, collenchyma and sclerenchyma. These are the very important tissues that we studied in this chapter further. So parenchyma is there, collenchyma is there and sclerenchyma is there. Now see, student, these parenchyma and collenchyma together, it is known as a chlorenchyma. Okay, this is collenchyma and parenchyma, and together they form a chlorenchyma. Okay, and the last one, that is the sclerenchyma, which is having a dead cells into it. Now, the complex tissue, which is made up of more than one type of a cell, they are also divided into two, and that is xylem and phloem. I think you all are knowing about the xylem and phloem, students. What are the xylem and the phloem tissues? These are the conducting tissues which is present in the plant. Okay, so they help in conduction of the thing from one place to the another, and that's why the name is conducting tissue. The role of a xylem and phloem play is very important in the plant, as it help in carrying the water and minerals from the roots to the leaves of the plant, which is a function of a xylem, help in carrying the water and the mineral to the leaves for carrying out the process of photosynthesis. While that of the phloem, when the food is prepared in the leaves, these tubes or these tissues help in taking that food from the leaves, which is prepared with that is starch or the glucose that we obtain after the process of photosynthesis. So that is taken by the phloem and then it is carried to the different part of the plant, including that of the shoot of the plant to that of the root of the plant. Okay, so it helps in conducting the food to each and every part of the plant. So their basic function is to carry the thing, carry water, mineral and food from one place or one part of the plant to the other part of the plant. Okay, and that's why they are also known as a conducting tissues. So these are the classification of the plant tissue that we will study one by one. Meristematic tissue, permanent, divided into simple complex. Parenchyma, collenchyma, sclerenchyma is very important. And then xylem and phloem.